this microphone. It is giving feedback, which makes it impossible for me to think. And I'm having a difficult time dealing with it. So if you could turn it down, I would be ever so grateful. Would you pray with me? We thank you, O God, for the gift of your love, and we offer and present to you, so far as we are able, all that we are, all that we have, and all that we do, as only an emptiness to be filled by you, until you are all in all, and we are complete. Through the one who is the very fullness of your love, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Fred Buechner paints a word picture of the Annunciation, our lesson today. He says, "She struck the angel Gabriel as hardly old enough to have a child at all, let alone this child. But he'd been entrusted with the message to give her, and he gave it. He told her what the child was to be named and who the child was to be, and something about the mystery that was to come upon her. 'You mustn't be afraid, Mary,' he said." As he said it, he only hoped that she wouldn't notice that beneath his great golden wings, he himself was trembling with fear to think that the whole future of creation hung now on the answer of a girl. The Annunciation, the angel Gabriel's visit to Mary, when he tells her the role that she can choose to have in bringing about the salvation of the world, is such a familiar story that I think we often forget how strange and mysterious it is. I think that we also forget how essential our lesson is today in our understanding of what it means to be a Christian. 6 months before our lesson takes place, the postmenopausal and so far childless Elizabeth and her equally elderly priest husband Zechariah conceived John the Baptist. Incidentally, that means they were probably about my age. Elizabeth and Zechariah had been unable to have children all of their lives, and in those days, infertility was thought to be a disgrace due to something that Elizabeth had done. The blame was always put on the woman, you see. If the story of Zechariah and Elizabeth teaches us anything, it should tell us that the heartbreak of infertility is not a disgrace, and certainly not something that God does to punish people, and that nobody is to blame for it. But I digress. Back to the story. 6 months before today's lesson, the angel Gabriel appears to Zechariah and Elizabeth and tells them all about the son they're going to have, John the Baptizer, and his role in salvation. Like Abraham and Sarah, as Fred Buechner also says, Zechariah had one foot in the grave and the other foot in the maternity ward. That's quite a distance, isn't it? Naturally enough, Zechariah asked the angel how such a thing is possible, and the angel strikes him mute until John is born. So 6 months into this pregnancy, the angel Gabriel comes to Mary. Mary was on the other end of the childbearing spectrum. She was a teenager, engaged to be married, and so she was not exactly supposed to be expecting. Anyhow, the angel says to her, "Rejoice, favored one, the Lord is with you." Our translation calls it, "Greetings, favored one." But the Greek word charein means rejoice, and was used as a common greeting. Our word Eucharist, meaning to give thanks, is connected with this word charein, to rejoice. So, if we do not rejoice greatly at every Eucharist, something is wrong. The Annunciation, today's lesson, was the beginning of the Incarnation. Think about that word for just a moment. nation belongs in a Mexican restaurant or the butcher shop instead of a theological seminary. It's about meat. It is literally when the God who is beyond time and space and creation chooses to become a piece of meat, just like us. As St. Athanasius said, Christ became what we are so that we might become what he is. So here is Mary, an unwed teenager from Little Nazareth, a tiny rural hilly village where construction workers who were working in the nearby city Sepphoris lived. Nazareth was to Sepphoris sort of like a village in Union County might be to Charlotte today. Imagine being an uneducated country girl from Mineral Springs, engaged to be married to an ordinary construction worker who built houses in Charlotte, except that it was 2,000 years ago, before electricity or telephones or printed books or radio or television or newspapers, and you lived in a one-room mud hut, or maybe a cave, just the side of Squalor, in a semi-arid, hot, dusty podunk of a town, in a time when women were treated just slightly better than slaves, in a country that was occupied by a bunch of brutal pagan foreign soldiers and economically pillaged by dishonest tax collectors. Suddenly, in the midst of this degradation, political oppression, and poverty, there appears this superhuman being who tells you, incredibly enough, that you are the luckiest person in the history of the world. Luke says that Mary was greatly troubled and wondered what kind of greeting that was. Well, I reckon so. She had to have been scared to death, because Gabriel says, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you found favor with God." And the angel tells her that she will become the mother of God in the flesh, the Son of the Most High, and her son will ascend to the throne of the Davidic monarchy and will reign as God forever. Now that is upward mobility. To go from a subjugated teenager from a podunk nowhere to be the mother of God in the twinkling of an eye. Well, Mary, like her relatives Elizabeth and Zechariah, is no dummy. In fact, she's absolutely brilliant. She knows that she's got no more chance of having a baby than her post-menopausal cousin Elizabeth. So naturally enough, she says, "How can I have a baby since I'm a virgin?" And the angel says that the Holy Spirit will come to her and overshadow her. Ponder that word. And therefore, her child is not going to be your average kid, but God in the flesh. Notice that Gabriel never gives her a chance to make any more excuses before he tells her, "You want proof? Well, you've got it. Your old cousin Elizabeth, who's never been able to have a child, is 6 months pregnant. For nothing is impossible with God." So therefore, Mary is gobsmacked by this outrageous, preposterous situation that has just turned the world upside down. There had to be, if you will excuse this expression, a pregnant pause as Gabriel waits for Mary's answer. And all of the heavenly realm of saints and angels and even God himself waits eagerly for her answer. Will she or won't she? A friend of mine, the Reverend Martha Jenkins, tells the wonderful story of going with her son to a Virginia Military Institute ring figure, a dance on the occasion of him receiving his class ring at VMI. I'm told that VMI ring figure is a very formal dance with sort of an unchanging protocol dating back to the 1920s, perhaps a throwback to another age. As each cadet enters the ballroom with their date, the couple is formally and publicly introduced. Martha said that when she was at this dance, as one couple entered the room and was introduced, the cadet, who happened to be a young man, suddenly broke the protocol, dropped to his knees, popped open an engagement ring box, and proposed to his beloved right on the spot. Martha says that the whole room was struck mute. Everything came to a grinding halt, and the room went silent. The young lady was put on the spot as her fiancé knelt in front of God, the universe, and everybody, proclaiming undying love for her. Martha said that this young man at the moment was perhaps the most vulnerable human being she had ever seen. There he was, so pitifully vulnerable. And the young lady was equally stunned and embarrassed. Martha said, "It seemed like an eternity of silence as the entire room waited for the young woman's response. The silence was so awkward, so painful, so vulnerable. And as they all stood there for what seemed like forever, Martha said she heard a little whisper from somewhere in the room. A little whisper that said, 'Please say yes. Martha was not sure whether the whisper was an audible reality or she was just hearing it in her heart of hearts. It strikes me that when the angel Gabriel appears to Mary with his outrageous offer for her to become the mother of God incarnate, that all the saints and angels in heaven, as they await her answer, whisper, "Fortunately for us all, Mary says, 'Here am I, the slave of the Lord, let it be with me according to your word.' And in her saying yes, all the history of salvation was changed, and the incarnation, the joining of humanity and divinity, was accomplished forever and ever in secula seculorum. Amen." And by the way, the young woman at the ring figure dance also said, "Yes." And Angel Gabriel disappears, and the world has never been the same. And it also seems to me that in the incarnation, every day, Jesus still comes to each one of us, drops to his knees, and makes his amazingly vulnerable proposal, standing at the door of our hearts and knocking. He tells us, "I love you enough to leave the comforts of heaven, enough to abandon immortality, enough to toss aside omnipotence. I love you enough to go through my entire earthly ministry of teaching and healing and forgiving. I love you enough to go through the horrible sacrifice of becoming human in the incarnation and going to death, even death on the cross, in the hopes that you will accept me and say yes." And here Jesus stands at the door of our hearts, kneeling, proposing, vulnerable, waiting for the stars. And as we too ponder this overwhelming love story, all the saints in heaven and on earth witnessing this amazing proposal again and again and again, as Jesus proposes to every person in every place and time, the angels in heaven whisper, "Please say yes. Please say yes." Just like the angel said to Mary, Gabriel says to each one of us, "Rejoice, you favored one. Lord is on your team. The monarch of heaven wants to move into the guest room of your heart, to share your life, to fill you with love, to grow in you as you grow in him. God grant that we may all have the wisdom of Mary and respond, let it be with me according to your word. And then let the adventure of our life in Christ begin. Please stand and join in the words of the night.